Hello everyone, let us continue with your social class. So in the previous class we have discussed up till page 132, that is until the topic modern India and colonial perspective, right? So let us continue the next topic today, that's sources of modern Indian history, page 132. I think we don't have much to cover it up. Yeah, hopefully we'll try to finish up end of the chapter today. Okay, so look into your text. In classes 6 and 7, we have already read about the significance of various sources which we use to understand the events and the changes during the ancient and medieval period. Similarly, there are a number of sources which we use to understand the modern period of Indian history. Some of these are described below. Alright, so basically, here we are going to see the different sources of modern Indian history. Okay, the history means to knowing about the past. So about the modern India, what are the sources which helps us to know about the past of the present India? The number one, that's administrative records. Administrative records such as government orders and official correspondence are significant sources of historical information. British officials believed that every official proceeding should be properly recorded to enable clarity and also to be available for future reference in case of disputes. The British also felt it necessary to preserve these records, which required separate rooms. Thus, each and every office, right from top down to the village, had special rooms. All branches of administration started the practice of communicating with each other in the form of letters, notings, reports, memos, etc. All these are preserved till this day in the archives. Alright, so basically administrative records, in simple term, if I explain you, a kind of a proper record maintenance, record of each and every event, no matter whatever office it is, be it the smallest office or be it the highest office. Okay, so the British government, they felt that, this information must be recorded so that in order to avoid any kind of future disputes, future conflict, or also it also helps us to support the decision which was taken then, that based on such and such criteria, this happened. Otherwise, now for example, the record that we have, like your examinations record, which we keep, which the school keeps, the teacher keeps. Now this record helps us a lot. Like for example, I'll give you, say, suddenly all of a sudden in one of the examinations, say you fall sick, all right? Any of the student falls sick, and he or she, because of the sickness, that particular examination, he or she is unable to do well. But which, that doesn't mean that the student is weak, because he or she couldn't perform as because the student wasn't well. So in that case, what do we do? We see the previous record, the previous performances, and based on that, a judgment is being taken. Now this previous records helps us to see the overall performance of that particular student throughout the year. So this is how it helps us to decide. So that is what administrative records, just one of the example that I gave you, that how it helps in knowing history, or the role that administrative record plays. Today also these records are being found. If you go, these are being preserved in the archives. Okay, next we have books. The printing press, invented in the 15th century by German named Johannes Gutenberg. Please underline that. When was the printing press invented? When and by whom? Subsequently, the print technology underwent many changes. With the arrival of the British, there was a huge growth in the production of books, magazine, newspaper, and journals. Books that contain a collection of speeches, like those delivered by Nehru, or the 100 volumes of Gandhiji's collected works, are still extremely important as they place the events in correct perspective. Similarly, Dadabhai Naroji's Poverty and Un-British Rule in India attacked the British government's economic policies and is an important source for the economic history of this period. Premchand wrote about the peasants and the downtrodden. The play Neel Darpan by Dinabandhu Mitra also highlighted the exploitation of workers at Indigo Plantation. Now see, books. There are so many examples given out here, but I'll give you one of the examples which you can relate to. Right now, the book that is in front of me, or which is in front of you. We are getting to know about this history, sources of modern Indian history, or about the colonial period, or the way they ruled us, the social changes, economical changes during their rule. How? How are we getting to know? It's because of the books. So same thing is being mentioned out here. Like this books is helping us to know about the then period. Likewise, there are many books which helps us to know about this, like some of the examples they have given, this, what you call, Dadabhai Naroji's, there's a book called Poverty and Un-British Rule in India, the name of the book. What do we know from that book? That book basically tells us that how, the British government's economic policies, okay, how the British government's economic policies attacked our economy, all right? And actually this helps us, this what do you call the, in order to understand the economic condition of our country of the past, this book gives us a, you know, it gives us a kind of a light, it gives us an information. Next, another book that we have, that is a, where is this, Premchand. Yeah, Premchand wrote, the name of the book isn't mentioned, but it's written that Premchand wrote about the peasants, which means farmers, the downtrodden, which means the poor people. So this is how, there is another play means a drama. There is a play called Neel Darpan, the name of the play, written by this Dinabandhu Mitra. Through this we also get to know how the workers, you know, they were exploited means making use of someone for your own personal interest, for your own personal benefit, without thinking about that particular his or her condition or his or her well-being. That's called exploitation. Under books, we also have autobiographies and biographies, like some of the autobiographies and biographies of prominent personalities such as Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru. They are also extremely important as a source of historical information for this modern period. Next, we have this books. It proved to be very much helpful. How? As they highlighted the exploitation of Indians by the British. Please underline that. How books proved to be helpful, as they highlight, and the examples, if the examples you can provide, like in the second paragraph, the one which I have discussed. As they highlighted the exploitation of the Indians by the British, whereas the government records tell us only what the British government officials thought or what they were interested in and what they wished to preserve for posterity. So see, now this is something you must understand. Books, with the help of the books, we get to know each and everything about, you know, of both sides of the coin, you can say that. Okay, a coin has got two sides. We get to know the Indian perspective as well as we get to know the British perspective as well. But whereas when we get to see only the government official records, in that scenario we are only able to know those things which the British government wanted us to know, as like only those records which they preserved, and the things which they didn't, we have no information with regard to that. This books helped in the spread of nationalist spirit among the masses. So it is like there were various methods, various policies or measures which were being implemented, because of which the feeling of nationalism spread among our people. Out of all those, you know, policies, measures or steps, this is one of the ways, this books, how, you know, the spirit of nationalism spread among the people, and today we are an independent country. Next, we have the newspapers, magazines, letters and pamphlets. Let's see what role does they play when it comes to modern Indian history. A large number of newspapers, magazines and pamphlets were printed throughout India in different languages. Some of these are still in publication with a record of their old edition systematically kept in their libraries. Bal Gangadhar Tilak's Kesari in Marathi is one of the most notable example. Underline. Bal Gangadhar Tilak's Kesari in Marathi is one of the most notable examples. Reading these papers recreates before us an atmosphere which prevailed 100 years ago or so. Letters are especially important as they help us understand the prevailing situation from a personal point of view. All right. So what role does newspaper, magazine, letters, pamphlets play? First of all, this particular newspapers, magazine, or you can say pamphlet. Okay, let us talk about newspaper, magazine and pamphlet firstly. Next, we'll go to letters. Now, these were printed across India in different languages, in all the regional languages, vernacular languages and all. Some of these publications, okay, they have even kept a record of their oldest edition, that too in a proper sequence, in a systematical manner, if you go into their libraries. One of the example of this newspapers, or you can say the old record of these old editions, this Bal Gangadhar Tilak Kesari, it was written in Marathi language. It's one of the best example. Now, when we read this newspapers, magazines or pamphlets, what happens is that it gives us a kind of, you know, it creates a picture in front of us. You can say an imaginary picture. We can take, like, with the help of the books, many a times it happens that when you watch music videos or when you watch movies, right, many a times we feel like that we're into that situation. We consider ourselves to be a part of that particular character. So many thought comes in our mind, and then, you know, we can feel it, we can experience it. That is what newspaper, magazines and pamphlet does. When we read them, what happens is that an atmosphere, okay, which existed 100 of years ago, that comes in our mind, and we can imagine, like, what were the situation then. We can feel it, all right? And what is the role of a letter? Letters basically help. Now, what is letter? Letter is basically a kind of personal talk, conversation, okay, between the sender and the receiver. That's what letter. Now, when we read a letter, we also get to understand the situation during those days from a personal perspective, from a personal point of view, as because it is basically a conversation. Nowadays, we rarely use letter, but now this, what do you call the social networkings that you have? What is this? Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, and all. When we chat, what do we do basically? We converse, we talk. Earlier days, there were no such thing. When we needed to talk with someone who is not in front of us, we used to do it in the form of letter. So letter means a personal talk. So basically, when we read the old letters of during those days, we get to know the situation which existed then, and that too from a personal perspective. Next, we have the photographs, paintings, and statues. Photography was a new art medium and extremely valuable as it captured historical moments for posterity and facilitated an almost perfect historical representation. Various statues and rare paintings are not only important as works of art, but they also tell us something about the physical feature and achievement of the national leaders and great historical personalities. All right, photography, a picture or statue, it helps us to understand in a much more better way. Why? Because we are able to visualize it, we are able to see in front of it. Now, for example, you see in your book, page number 132, there is in the page 132 itself, on the left hand side, right at the bottom, you see there is a National Archives of India building and all, kind of a, you can say a library, okay, kind of. So when you see this picture and just read, you can imagine it. Why? Because it's in front, it's a kind of a visualization, okay. You're able to imagine, you're able to understand in a much more better way. See another picture of this Munshi Premchand. When you see the person, you can just by looking at the picture, it gives you a kind of an understanding that, okay, like look at his age or his face and all, the way he looked, right? So that's what photography. Now, photography was something which was very much new during those days, okay? But however, it played a very important role. It was quite important. Why? Because it captured those past moments, and at the same time, because of which it was possible, you know, for this proper historical representation, as because of this photography. Next, we have films. Documentary as well as feature films also help in the study of this period. What do you mean by documentary? Get the meaning of it. Documentary as well as feature films also help in the study of this period. The impression left after watching such film is of more permanent nature as we see events with our own eyes. Example which I gave you recently, right, about films and all. Sir Richard Attenborough's film Gandhi includes an actual news reel of Gandhiji's visit to Manchester. I hope you understand the difference between reel and real. Reel is basically, the event which is being captured in the form of technology like movies and all, which is not happening in reality. But however, there are many reels, okay, which depicts reality. Another film called Achyut Kanya, the love story of an untouchable girl and a Brahmin boy, was a commercial success. Many such films are stored with the film division. So basically, I gave you the explanation that what role does film play. The one more I'll repeat it, the most important role played by a film is that, you know, it helps us to understand in a much more better way, as because we see events with our own eyes, we can feel it, okay, we can experience, we can put our own self in that particular situation. And some of the examples of the films which gives us a good information about the past, one is the film titled as Gandhi, written by by whom? By Sir Richard Attenborough. And the another film, that's Achyut Kanya. Okay, some of the examples. All right, there's a blue box, a greenish type, page 133, where some of the names of the newspaper, the founder, the editor, and also the language in which it was printed and the year of launch. Please go through it, memorize the same. You may be asked that, write the name of 10 newspapers, okay, of the past days, of which helped us in knowing Indian history, and also, or maybe any name of newspaper can be mentioned, and you may be asked who was the founder of it, when was it launched, in which language it was published. So you have to memorize all those. Next, we have monuments. Monuments are basically, you know, these buildings and all. Let's see. A number of famous monuments and buildings belonging to this period can be seen throughout the length and breadth of the country. Most of these have many stories and episodes linked with them. Some of these are the India Gate, Parliament House, Rashtrapati Bhavan, and Birla House, where Gandhi was assassinated. All these buildings tell us much about our near past and the different aspects of the architecture of India of that time. So basically, monuments, buildings, like what about these monuments that we have? It's not coming up in my mind right now exactly. All right, the forts, the buildings which were built in the past, like the book, let me give you the example which is mentioned in the book. One of the example, like India Gate. When you see this India Gate and all, or when you visit the place, there is a history behind it. Why was it built? When was it built? And when you see this, or when you visit this monuments and building, you get to know about the reason of that particular monument being constructed. So as a result, ultimately what happens to us is we get to know about the past, which means history. So it gives us information about the past, about the history. So this is how monuments and buildings helps us in knowing about history. I hope you got. Now another monument, like for example, it's not basically a monument. Now if I give you the example of this, what you call statue that we have here, right in our locality, on this river Brahmaputra, this the famous warrior of Ahom kingdom, Lachit Borphukan, right? When you see this, the moment you see this, or say somebody, an outsider visited in our place who is unaware about this, so if anybody asks like, why is this statue being built here, or who is he? So there is a history behind it, there is a story behind it, there is a fact behind it. So when we, you know, narrate that, ultimately what is happening, we are talking about the past, we are talking about the history, and the person who is new to our place, he or she also gets to know information, gathers knowledge about the past, that okay, because of such and such reason, or he is such and such person, because of this, his statue is being built. So this is how they played. I just give you the example of one of the statues. So monuments also and buildings also plays the same role. Okay, they provide us information about the past. Next, we have surveys and mapping. The British believed that a country had to be properly known before it could be effectively administered. So they started by conducting surveys, mapping, etc. The Survey of India was set up in Dehradun, underlined, which made detailed map of towns, villages, mountains and coast. The first Surveyor General of Bengal was appointed in 1767, underline that as well. And the first Surveyor General of India in 1815. Okay, so do not get confused. One is Surveyor General of Bengal and the other one is Surveyor General of India. George Everest became the Surveyor General in 1830. And in 1849, the height of Mount Everest was calculated and it was named after him for his exemplary contribution. All right. Another piece of information. See, you get to know from books. So this is how sources of Indian history, or sources of history, you can say. See, we say Mount Everest, Mount Everest. But why it is being termed as Mount Everest? Why not Mount something else? Why Everest only? Because of this reason. George Everest, he became the Surveyor General in 1830, and in 1849, the height of this particular mountain, okay, was calculated and it was named after him, as because it was he who calculated the exact height, the proper height, and as a result it got its name as Mount Everest because of his contribution. The map of the Hyderabad region made by Dr. H. W. Voysey in 1821 was the first proper geological map in India. Underline. Maps of towns, cities, villages and roads, etc. are made. This maps helps us today to know about the kind of rural and urban patterns of settlement. In villages, revenue surveys were conducted. From the end of the 19th century, census. Do you know what is census? It's basically, you know, this is what you call getting to know the population. If I say the census of our country, that means the population, okay? Population of our country. Where am I? Yeah. From the end of the 19th century, census operations were held every 10 years to prepare detailed record of the number of people. See, it's written here. To prepare detailed records of the number of people in India, which means population, census. All right. So that is the role of map and survey. There is a matter of fact which is given just below the paragraph and page 134 as well as in 132, the example which I gave you. With that image of the building, the National Archive of India. So all this, please go through it. And also the box which is page 134. major sources of modern Indian history, literary, administrative and non-administrative, and non-literary. All right, I hope you know the difference between literary and non-literary writings. Okay, non-literary, picture, images, photograph, monument, buildings and all. There are this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 key points are being mentioned in page 135. And yes, as usual, please memorize the glossary. All right, without understanding the meaning, you will not be able to frame the sentence. So we are done with the chapter. With this, we come to the end of the chapter. So now it's up to you, right? We have discussed almost each and every word. Please go through the, not almost, we discuss every word, every line, every single line. So go through the text and complete the exercise. Okay, see you in the next class. Stay at home, study well.